Girl, Drew Sidora and this song, as soon as they played it, all I heard was 1-800-INJURED. After you get hit, hit Bethune. Y'all already know what time it is. I got the black beat neck on. Atlanta season 15 episode 2. Let's get into it. Girl, Drew and this song and this Zane novel book cover for her album or a single, girl, has me screaming. Let's get into this episode of Real Housewives Atlanta. We are still on head butt gate saga situation. Candy was not in the wrong at all. Courtney was turned up for no absolute reason. And I already told y'all, she seemed like she was very attention hungry. She was clout chasing. That's something Candy has already said. I think that Courtney feels some type of way because it is the truth. Like, Courtney does give clout chaser vibes. And that's just what it is. And Candy can smell it a mile away. Like, Candy can smell it. And it's just, girl, I wish she could smell them burnt biscuits full of bullets. But, you know, she smelled the bull crap with Courtney. Sanya said, girl, I ain't got time for this. I gotta go on my own stuff. This is about Ross. I done spent $100,000 on this party. So we get Kenya and Martel turned up to the max. For what reason, I don't know. Martel clearly in the wrong, to be honest. Martel 100% in the wrong. Like, it was just not necessary for him to do all of that with Kenya. He could have said, hey, like, let me see what's going on. Like, the energy that he gave Kenya, I'm not surprised that Kenya was laughing and saying, hey, this man is aggressive and I'm uncomfortable. Like, the way she laughed, it gave me a nervous laugh. Like, hey, like, and I feel like Martel didn't read up on that. He didn't feel the energy. Like, maybe I am doing too much. He was like, oh, can she talk? Can she? Like, it was just way too much. Considering Martel's track record with women, he should have just said, hey, let me see what's going on. Da, da, da. Like, yeah, I did. You're a beautiful woman. And, you know, you ain't responding to the message. You know, it's cool. I'm dating Sheree. Da, da. It's just a way to do things, but Martel is an idiot. And I don't feel like Kenya was wrong to call him out on it. I do think this conversation of him being in the DMs is tiring because, you know, y'all are in the Bravo universe, reality show universe is very small. Y'all all doing stuff for attention to be on the show. I mean, come on now. So it's not surprising. Y'all could have had a conversation about this and left it alone. Like, Sheree, like, if one thing Sheree gonna do is defend a man who don't need to be defended.
Hold
like,
on,
girl,
check me, bro.
Sheree, it's just not the best, like, girl. And, you know, I don't like that Kenya was kind of trying to call Martel abusive. I felt like that was a little bit of a reach. That was a reach, abusive. Yeah, he was being, like, I don't know. Like, that's quick. Now, I get the conversation about, now, I've seen the conversation where it's like, oh, like, Kenya has a history of calling, you know, black men aggressive. And I feel like this is some reverse type of stuff. Like, you putting this label on black men and, you know, what are you trying? Are they public enemy number one? And I'm just like, girl, like, I do feel like when Kenya has called folks aggressive, it has been like the guy, the cousin, who was cutting up. Like, when they was at the, like, what was it? They're on vacation. He was cutting up real bad. Even though Kenya was kind of flirting with him or whatever, he was doing the absolute most. He was doing the most, and he was aggressive. And they trying to flip that on her and make her seem like that she is a byproduct of white supremacy by saying, oh, you're calling these black men aggressive and you labeling them. I do feel like Martel was aggressive. As far as abusive, I just feel like that was a little bit of a reach. He's not put his hands on anybody. He's not cussed nobody out. He's not been mentally abusive from what we've seen to Sheree. Like, it's just, I don't know. I guess Kenya's trying to use that to kind of, like, help Sheree. But you don't help a victim of things by bringing up, see, you made a bad decision last time, so I'm trying to protect you. That's not what you, like, that's...
Talk that tea.
I don't know, like, the range is not ranging for this whole conversation. Like, it's just a lot. But I feel like Martel could have dealt with this differently. He could have just said, hey, girl, you know, beautiful woman. Like, you know, this happened. a while back. We don't talk no more, like da da da, or whatever. It wasn't that necessary. And it's tired. I don't want to continue talking about this anymore. I feel like this was a whole tired storyline. We get to our girl, 1-800-INJURED. If y'all don't live in Atlanta, there is a commercial. Type it in, girl, and come back to me. Come back. 1-800, after you get hit Bethune, it took me out. Do you hear me? It took me out because as soon as Drew started singing this song, I was like, oh, girl, it's giving me, after you get hit Bethune. I was like, girl, she's singing the background vocals for these ambulance chaser lawyers. Like, girl, I was cracking up. Like, I was cracking up. She was in love with the song. She loves it. She, you know, she's talking to Ralph. And you can tell, you can't tell what's going on with them because they're honestly supposed to be headed towards a divorce at some time during the show. But they look like they're pretty good. They look decent, I guess you would say. I don't know. A little bit decent. And I'm just confused. But, you know, Drew is sharing that the family emergency was her father dealing with Alzheimer's, and she said she went to go visit him and he's forgetting her, but once she sung for him, he remembered. Very, very sweet. It was like, okay, like we're getting invited into Drew's life. Ralph, whatever he got going on. I'm not a big fan of Ralph, I'm just not. So we don't know where their relationship is at right now. It looks like it's kind of pretend. And they might be pretending that they about to break up and divorce to have a storyline for next season, girl. That's rinse, wash, repeat. It's the same story. So we get to Candy, girl. Candy and the restaurant. Her and Todd are sitting down at, what is the name of it? Ace Hardware. What's the name of the place there? The little Blaze restaurant. They're at Blaze. And, you know, they talking about the menu. They, you know, talking about the, like, you know, stuff they want to do. And Todd brings up a point that I want to talk about. Todd said he's made so much money from, like, restaurants. The most money he's ever made. And I'm going to tell y'all, I've been telling y'all why Todd and Candy have been making a lot of money from these restaurants. Because they squeeze every dollar. And I get it. Like, all the restaurants, like, find some way to do it. They mess over employees. They do. But there are some restaurants who don't do it. But this is the conversation I keep trying to have about black capitalism. Because we keep thinking that, oh, you know, black capitalists like Candy are going to save us. Oh, like, you know, Candy is literally squeezed. Candy and Todd squeezing every dollar out of these folks to make a buck. Like, they've been able to make the most money because they're not investing that money into their restaurant. I'm so sorry. I don't have anything against Candy or Todd or anything, but just going to these restaurants, y'all are not putting any money in the restaurant, let alone the servers or the staff, which gets into the conversation the producers have to say, hey, are we going to talk about the elephant in the room? Apparently one of, you know, the workers, you know, shot an employee who is her cousin, who is her manager.
Accused of shooting a co-worker at a restaurant owned by reality star Candy Burris is in custody tonight. It happened at the Blaze Steak and Seafood restaurant on Cascade Road.
As they should be, considering how high volume that the restaurants do. They get a lot of customers in these restaurants, but y'all are working the hell out of these folks. Like, all these black-owned restaurants I know, and I know people who've worked there, say the same thing. Right now, you got stuff going on with Slutty Vegan, who, you know, unfortunately, Pinky loved her. Actually met her a couple years ago. Very sweet girl. Her restaurant and stuff has been under fire for not paying her employees and stealing wages from her employees. That's why I keep reiterating black capitalism. Black capitalists like Candy, Todd, and all these folks are not going to save us, because to become rich, to become millionaires and billionaires, you have to steal from the working class. There's no other way around it, and that's exactly what's happening. That's why Todd is saying, oh, I made the most money. Like, girl, your employees are so irate that they come in here getting into it with managers and shooting them. Like, girl, what's going on? Like, that's not happening everywhere. And I don't like that Candy's trying to blame it on the high crime in Atlanta. The crime in Atlanta is not up like that. So stop trying to sell that damn, what's the story? Crime in Atlanta is going up. And if crime is going up, it's because wages are stagnant. Like, people do not have resources. People do not have resources. Crime ain't got nothing to do with your employees coming.
Are you always lying?
You probably ain't running no decent background checks on folks. You're paying folks pennies at this restaurant, which is why the only people who are taking it don't have a choice. That happens in the restaurant industry. And they know that. That's how these restaurants are able to, they're hire cooks who have gotten out of jail or who can't find work, and they offer them pennies because they can't find any other jobs that pay them well. So they're gonna take this job. So like, girl, this, so I'm not blaming this on Candy, but I'm blaming this on capitalism. Like, I'm not saying that, you know, Candy is not, what's the name from this? Like, Candy is not the number one public enemy, number one when it comes to this, but she is very much a capitalist. And then we're hearing Todd say, oh, you know, she, you know, this, and you're hearing Todd say stuff like, oh, I made the most money I've ever made off a restaurant. Yeah, I can imagine so, because y'all out here extrapolating every penny out of y'all workers, and y'all wonder why they pulling up to the job with Glocks and getting into it with managers. They looking at like, you know, you working here, you being paid decent, and you straight, because Candy gonna get you, and I'm right here getting paid pennies. Now, I don't know this story is 100%, but I would not be surprised, because I've been in restaurant environments for more than half of my life, and a lot of that comes from the people who they hire because they're not paying them a decent wage. People who are being paid decent wages are not turning up on their jobs like that. They're just not. So when you pay your employees right, you wouldn't have to deal with no issues like that. And I've already heard about all these restaurants having a high turnover rate and nobody staying there long, child. So that's a whole mess. But I'm glad they clocked it. It was like, hey, girl, we're going to talk about the elephant in the room. They want to talk about it. But they said, girl, we're going to have a conversation. Now, Sheree had me screaming when she said, we don't know if we're going to get biscuits or bullets. I screamed. And the girl said, Sheree, we don't know if we're going to get a welcome party or foreclosure when it comes to your house. Girl, that ugly house, girl. Furniture or foreclosure. Baseboards or baseline, girl. I don't know. Did they even match? It don't even matter. But yeah, like, the girls were dragging Candy fell into the, oh, Atlanta crime is going up. Stop saying stuff like that. We're in the middle right now of trying to stop Atlanta City Council from building a cop city. Like, people turned up to the meeting yesterday, Monday in Atlanta, talking about, like, the community showed up and said they do not want a city in Atlanta that's dedicated to police. They don't want that. They do not want that. If you haven't heard about it, type it in, search it. It's on Twitter, it's on social media, type in on Google, stop cop city. We cannot afford to build a city for police in Atlanta when we are having a serious housing insecurity situation going on in Atlanta. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't make any sense. Spend money on the community, on the people, not on police. Like, what's going on? Like, that doesn't make any sense to me. Y'all need to be more tapped in with y'all community, other than offering them piss poor jobs. No shade. So Kenya is hanging out with some girl and her child, and I thought that was really cute. I can't remember her. It just wasn't really that memorable. They went to go play tennis. Brooklyn looks so cute playing tennis. The little girl's playing tennis. It was really cute. And then she sits down. It looks like somebody who Kenya is really cool with, friend of the show situation. I don't know if I'm sold on the story. I just don't know. Her husband was fine. I just don't know what's going on. But she tells her about everything that's going on, and Kenya brings up this divorce from Mark that's been going on for 10 years. At this point, if you ain't divorced this man yet, it's because you don't want to divorce him. So it's just like, you got a child, y'all got a baby, beautiful child. Let's move on. Let's talk about something else. Let's make these plates for these men, because I'm tired. Drew working on music. She and Abby, you get hit me through. Sitting down with the producer, her and Ralph working on, Ralph can play the keyboard. Like, he playing the keyboard. Drew is over there singing, and Drew is saying that she wants to, you know, work on music. Like, that's her passion. That, you know, her father has inspired her to continue pursuing music and stuff. I think that's cute. I don't know if that's going to work for her, but, you know, apparently next episode we're going to see her do a crossover with Candace from Real Housewives of Potomac, and she's going to be performing with her, not with her, but on the stage after she's done something. I don't know that. The song, I listened to it a little bit in the studio, not live. If you can catch that joke, where that comes from, I will send you $50 in the studio, not live. Where did that come from? Because that was iconic to me, but it's a little bitty, like, YouTube fact. Oh, that I used to say a long time ago. Wow, amazing. So many things have changed. In the studio, not live. Girl, gagged her, girl. That was a mess. Sanya and Candy sitting down having dinner, and I love that Candy questioned. Sanya was just like, okay, girl, when homegirl was joking and saying that, you know, I invite the hood out, what did you say to defend me? Sanya didn't defend her. Like, that's how I am. The moment Courtney would have said something about, oh, she brung the hood, like the next week it was hood, I would say, girl, what you mean by hood? Black folks showing up? That's how my reaction would have been. Like, automatically, like, girl, what you mean the hood? Because black folks showed up? And that would have been that. But Sanya started laughing. Not the hood, girl. Now, I don't think Sanya was intentionally, like, being shit, but it's like, girl, if you cool with her, you should have been like, girl, what you mean? Huh? But, you know, it's not genuine. It's not genuine, Sanya. So, girl, you getting caught up in that mess, girl. You should have been, I don't know. You should have played your cards right. You ain't play your cards right with that. But she did get clocked, and Candy clocked her while she was eating that soup. Candy kept eating that food. Candy isn't me when it comes to food, because I be eating. I love me some food. So, girl, that whole ghetto conversation, that was a mess. We get to Sheree and Kenya. Sheree is at the Sheba Shit Factory with wrinkled hoodies. Sheree spent all this time talking about fashion, to be going to a big facility that is putting Sheba Sheree hoodies in a box. Like, all this stuff is, like, it's just not real. It's just not real. Like, all of it's for play. It don't make any sense to me. And then you got Sonya over there kicking with Sheree. Girl, son, you better watch out. Candy is the longest running housewife on this show. I would not be, Sheree can't keep a job on this show. What did Kenya say? Sheree came back to Atlanta. How many times? Like, she been fired so many times. Oh my God, what's some joke she said on Watch What Happened Live? It had me gagging. But Kenya shows up talking to Sheree and, just like, hey girl, that whole thing with Martel, that was a lot going on. And Sheree's like, no, you're trying to create a narrative. You're trying to say that black men are aggressive. And that's when the whole abuse conversation comes in that I felt like was way too much. But, you know, I felt like Kenya was trying to like let her know, like, hey girl, this man don't seem good. But also bringing up that, you know, she had a situation with Bob that was abuse. I don't think that was the right way to go to talk about someone's past with abuse, because it's not that Sheree is picking bad men that are abusive. It's just a whole bunch of men that are out here being abusive. I don't think that's like Sheree picking these folks. Like, I don't like that. I don't like that aspect of the conversation, but I don't think that Martel is abusive. I think that he's just a shitty man. And I think that Sheree looks over there because of what that man looks like. And I'm just like, I see a lot of people do that, unfortunately. Desire Capital, we'll talk about it. Cause ain't no way in here. I ain't no way in the head. But they don't have no chemistry. It's giving a whole, like, show anyway. But this was a decent second episode. I'm ready for the intros to see what they give. Next week, we're going to get Marlo going off on Drew for some reason. I'm very curious of what that's going to be given. And I think that's all I can remember. But this episode was cute. Now, after next week, I will be putting all of my Real Housewives Atlanta reviews on Patreon. So if you're interested in watching Real Housewives Atlanta reviews, they will be on Patreon after this one. But I appreciate you all supporting. Shout out to the patrons for out here supporting me each and every month. I love y'all so much. And until next time, talk to y'all later. Bye.